everyone. Good morning. Good to see you all here today. While Emily's finishing getting a couple more chairs for people, we're going to go ahead and get started. Is that okay? My name is Stephanie Sanford, and as you see on the slide, I work here at BIOLA as the Director of Global Student Programs and Development. And this is my best friend, Dorothy.
Hi.
She works as a professor in the comm department.
And so,
I love it. Before we get started and dive into our content, we want to see who's in the room today. So if you're here from BIOLA, raise your hand. Whoa. What up, people? What up? Okay, what other schools do we have in the room?
Vanguard.
Woo-hoo. Love it. What else?
I almost went there.
Fresno Pacific.
Woo! Fresno Pacific. You too, huh? Nice. Who else?
Everybody?
George Fox. Pepperdine. Very cool. Very nice. Cool. Anybody else?
Northwestern.
Awesome.
Cool. APU.
Life Pacific College. You guys are from the same school. APU. I used to work there. It's a good school. Anybody else? Anybody else? Okay, very, very diverse group. I hope that you guys all feel comfortable talking to each other today and getting to know each other, maybe even BIOLA people getting to know people from other schools. Does that sound okay? Yeah. Awesome. Real quick, with the BIOLA people, how many of you are in Res Life? Love it, love it. Nice. I'm seeing you for the second time this year. Hope you're having a good year. It's awesome. What other student leadership groups do we have represented?
Senators.
SGA. SGA is in the house. Very nice. What
Communication
else?
And diversity. Yay! My students.
What do you have? Awesome. Oh, nice. Club. Very cool. Global students. Woo, woo! Got the global students in the house. Anybody else? Leadership?
What about from the other universities, too? Are you part of leadership groups, I'm assuming?
Yeah, what do you guys do at your universities?
I'm an intern with Intercultural Life, and then we also have
President of George Fox?
ASC.
Student government, right? I was like, whoa! George Fox, president!
Hey, a young president!
I know,
that's
right?
Awesome.
Man, advanced. Or maybe some Botox or something, I don't know. Joking. President, student, president. It's awesome. So in this room, we have a lot. Do you guys want chairs?
I'm fine.
Are you saying I'm fine or that I would prefer a chair?
I'm great.
Oh, you're great. Okay. What about you, my dear? Would you like a chair? You're happy?
Yep.
Okay. Whoever wanted a chair has a chair.
Great.
Well, we're so happy to see you all here today, and we hope that this time is going to be fun, interactive, and most importantly, that we all learn a little something today, right? We didn't come here just to hang out and relax on a Saturday morning. There's better things to be doing on a Saturday morning, I'm sure.
No.
No. Better than this?
No.
Okay, great.
Better than us? I don't think
never,
so.
Never. Okay. Sorry, we're best friends, so we play off each other a lot. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started.
All right. So as Stephanie said, my name is Dorothy Alston-Colley, and we are best friends. So we have known each other for about 18 years now. We met in a biology study group here at BIOLA, and we have been through a lot of life together. We have been housemates. Stephanie was one of the bridesmaids in my wedding, and my kids call her Auntie Steph, and seriously, she is one of their very favorite people in the whole entire world. They just scream with joy when they see her. And so today we are really excited to be here with you to talk to you about these things that we have really gone through a lot in our own lives together, and then also things that we've implemented professionally at the same time. And so we're excited to share a lot of what we've learned with you today.
Great. So you know the title of our talk is going to be about learning to listen, engaging with others, and cultural humility. We want to really focus this time centered upon one specific verse, the greatest command that our Lord Jesus gave to us. Do you know what it is? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And what's the second part, you guys?
Love your neighbor as yourself.
What we often don't think about, though, is right after Jesus says this, he has one more statement. Do you know what it is?
There's no greater commandment.
That would be in the Matthew version. In the Luke version, it says this, do this and you will live. And I think he's talking here about eternal life, but also about this life we have on earth. really focusing on the fact that our lives should be lived in relationship with our Heavenly Father, reconciliation to Him, but also as equally important is our reconciliation to one another, our relationships to one another. Oftentimes we focus on our relationship with Him and we don't focus on our relationships with one another. So what we are here today is to talk about how do we focus on this part of our eternal life, right? One day when we're all in heaven together, we'll be going to be worshiping Jesus together. Why don't we start practicing that even now here? And there's a lot of tools that we can use to practice that, no matter what environment that we go into. So our goals for you today are really three basic things. Number one, to deepen our understanding of our identities and how they are constructed. If you're a comm major, maybe you know a little bit about this already. We're going to deepen that. Number two, develop awareness of good question-asking skills. How do we ask good questions? And then finally, we're going to learn to engage as a learner with a posture of cultural humility. Listening is a very difficult thing that we need to practice continually. So these are our three goals for today. Doral?
So as Stephanie was just talking about, something that we hear a lot is that we need to love our neighbor as ourselves, right? But I think practically speaking, it's really hard to understand how to do that, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's really hard to know how to begin to even approach that. And so in larger culture, even beyond Christian culture, we get a lot of different messages, don't we? So in the media, you hear about Black Lives Matter, and then you hear about All Lives Matter. Okay, and then 3 weeks ago, there was a very, one of the most famous people in the world, Beyonce, came out with her video Formation, right? Any of you watch that? Yeah. Some of you watched it in my class this week, okay? And then Kendrick Lamar came out, or he didn't come out with it, but he performed at the Grammys, right? Mm-hmm. And that was a very impactful video too. And so sometimes it can be hard to process all of this information that you're getting and to know where you stand on it. And so that's why we're going to be going through these three things today, because we believe that as followers of Christ, we need to be able to build our capacity to take in ideas and to understand them from a Christ-like perspective. So we're going to talk about how to engage with one another as learners in cultural humility. And that word humility is really key, okay, to come at one another with a humble attitude. And then by asking good questions, because if you think about it, it's hard to do that sometimes when you're sitting with somebody that's new to you to know how to even begin to engage with them. And then also we're going to talk about how you can listen well, okay? Because that's a key initial part of learning how to engage in good relationships with other people.
I think most of us really want to do what Jesus said and love the Lord our God and love our neighbors as ourselves. But there are a lot of barriers we experience when it comes to loving others. One of the biggest barriers that we might face is really focusing on what we have in common while glossing over our differences. What makes us unique as people? I often hear students at Biola say this phrase, "We all come from different families, areas of the world, and cultural perspectives, but we are one in Christ." Isn't this a true statement? It is a very true statement. But oftentimes, we use this to gloss over, erase, or pass by the fact that actually we do have a lot of differences. We are one in the sense of we are many parts of one body, but that doesn't make us exactly the same, right? If we look around the room today, we immediately see differences. Now, I know this hairstyle with the curly hair is in, and a lot of girls are doing that, right? But that does not mean that we are the same. We all grew up very differently. We have different parents. We have different stories. And sometimes it's really hard to think about the differences because we feel like it'll bring conflict. Actually, it's just the opposite. The differences are going to make us closer to one another. They're going to help us to understand one another more deeply and really be the body of Christ that Jesus wants us to be. But oftentimes there's a huge fear or judgment of others who are different. I don't know if you guys have ever experienced this, but you see something new or different and you say, strange, awkward. Have those words ever come out of your mouth before? Awkward, anybody? Awkward. When we say these words like awkward, strange, weird, what are we really implying? What are we really saying? I would contest that we're saying who I am and my experience is norm. That other thing that's shocking me is different and maybe wrong. Right? Yeah? Why are we fearful of others? Actually, I think this is a human problem. We're fearful of differences because we were never taught to really value differences well. Right? And that is part of Jesus' call to us as well. Oftentimes, I think a lot of this is based on assumptions that we have due to lack of information. What we see in the media, what we experience in our home lives growing up, we might not necessarily know the whole story behind a person, right? Assumptions based on lack of information. Let me give you a quick example. So I work here. I'm the director of Global Students Programs and Development here. So that basically means I get to hang out with all the international students, all the third culture kids, all the missionary kids, anybody that's grown up outside of the U.S. Now, I didn't grow up outside of the U.S. I grew up in Long Beach, California. Anybody? Okay. Love it. So when I was first hired at the university to be the director of this program, the students and a few of the staff members gave me this really cool welcome party. And they prepared food, and then they had like a time where my parents could come, actually, which was really interesting. And they all gathered together.
I know, right? You ever told me that part.
I know, it's really weird. Anyway, weird, see? Mm-hmm. Comes out of my mouth. They had this time where they all gathered, and they welcomed me in, and they shared with me. So they asked me questions. What about this? What about this? And I shared some of this stuff with them. Just really, really nice time. I was really nervous, actually. Because did you know that our global students here at Biola come from 60 different countries? So many different language backgrounds, so many different stories, and here I am, right? This newcomer walking into the situation, not knowing what to expect. I walked away feeling like, I don't really know. Did they like me or not? Later on, maybe 3 or 4 months later, one of the students that was there that day, he and I had become friends over the course of that next 4 months, and he said to me, Stephanie, I want to confess something to you. I was like, bring it. I thought he was going to, you know, deep, dark secret, you know? He's like, when we met you that first day, we thought there's no way she can understand what it feels like for us to leave our families and come to the States and be a student here. She has no idea what it's like to learn a second language and to really struggle in academics. There's no way this woman could ever resonate with us. And I was like, because you know, you realize that there's a lot of assumptions there. But then he said, I want to apologize to you. My assumption was incorrect. I assumed based on appearances only and not the reality of your situation. Now that I've heard your story, I know. You get me. You understand me. And I was like, that is the most beautiful model of what it means to break down assumptions, right? We're doing it through relationships. And so oftentimes we experience fear when it comes to people who are different than us. But I would contest to this. We can build trust over time. We can build trust with people that are different from us. But trust is built only when we seek what? Deep mutual understanding. Not glossing over differences, but really seeking to understand what makes you unique and different. So now we're going to go into a time where we start to understand the various layers that make us who we are, and we're going to do an activity together. Does that sound okay, you guys? Is it hot in here? It's a little hot. Can we open
the
door?
Sorry, I closed the door. It's loud.
It's open the door.
It distracts me.
Okay. Hot or distractions? What do you guys want? Distractions. Distractions. I know, the AC is kind of broken in here. Bummer, huh? But you guys are good. You guys are good? Okay. So is this making sense so far? Good. So we want to approach this next part interactively.
Yes. So one way that we can seek to begin to understand people around us is by actually learning about ourselves. okay? Because if you don't know anything about yourself and you haven't done a lot of due diligence in order to gain some self-awareness, you might not even realize, okay, well, I just thought that thing that other person did was weird, but let's back up and think, why was that weird, okay? Why did that feel that way to me? Mm-hmm. Why did I experience it in that way? And so a great way that we can begin to approach learning about who we are and then use that as a way of beginning to understand others is by looking at social identities, okay? So this is a social identity wheel. I know that it looks like a lot when you first see it, okay? So first housed in the middle is personality. We all have our own amazing personality that God gave us and that we were born with, okay? But then around personality are some specific identities. And these are all identities that we are born with, okay? These are things that we can't change about ourselves. In the next ring, you look at those things, and those are all things that you can change about yourself, right? Some might argue that religion would be something that you can't change. So some of those might, we could talk through whether or not we could change them about ourselves, but a lot of these you can change, right? Like appearance. When I was in college, I had my hair cut to be about this long, and it was bright purple. Okay.
Nice.
So I was able to change my appearance, not my best look, right?
No,
not my best look. parental status, right? So do you live with your parents? Have your parents passed away or your primary caregivers? Also, do you choose to become a parent? Mm-hmm. Okay. And then around the largest circle that you have, those are some things that some of you might have already experienced, but you will begin to experience those more and more the older you get and the more life experience you gain when you graduate from college. Anybody already graduated from college in here? We didn't ask that. You did. Okay, so as you've graduated from college already, you know that you've probably experienced more of those types of identities. So what we're going to do next is I want you to be able to think through and process through which of these identities you have, okay, and what they're like for you. So Stephanie mm-hmm. and Emily, maybe if you can hand out these sheets. What we're going to do is I'm going to, they're going to hand around to you a social identity wheel for you to fill out yourself, okay? So does anybody else have questions about the difference between race and ethnicity?
Eye-opening.
Yeah, because I'm getting a lot of those, so I know that that's always a big one. It is really hot back here.
Yeah.
It's because of you, isn't it?
She's like, yep.
I know it's because you're here. Or maybe it's because the two of us are together, right? Uh-huh.
So the difference between race and ethnicity, let me ask first, does anybody know or anybody have ideas about that? Before I tell you my definition of it?
That girl.
Any guesses? Yes. Can you hear her? Did you all hear her over there? Okay, so race would be a broader category, and then you're saying ethnicity would be more specific to the country. Okay, so that's a good starting point for that. The way that I generally explain it, and if you start looking up in sociology books, and I look at a lot of sociology, psychology, and communication studies, so and intercultural studies, when you look through those books, there are a lot of different definitions. But the way that I like to explain it is that race is a socially constructed category, okay? And so when we look at race, race is something that was developed particularly as a mechanism for racism, okay? Because a certain group of people wanted to be able to particularly economically oppress other people. And so they decided what was right was to really be white, okay? Because by being white, that meant that you could have economic power, and laws were made to support that. So in the US particularly, who were the only people at first that were allowed to vote?
White males.
White males, right? Okay, and that was based on those racial classifications. Versus ethnicity, which then does begin to have to do with perhaps countries, but even countries, why that gets a little bit broad, is even within many countries, there are many different ethnicities. Like when I went to China, I can't remember, there's like hundreds and hundreds of different ethnicities within China, right? For those of you maybe that have visited China or are from China even. And so ethnicity becomes a way of thinking about culture, language, experience, okay? And all of those things. So what I would say for myself is that racially, I'm white, but ethnically, my mother is Jewish, and she's particularly a Russian Jew, so I have that as a part of my ethnicity. And then in addition, my dad was Scottish and English and some other things that we don't know about, because when immigration happened, what happened in the US is that whiteness became more important than that ethnicity. And so we lost a lot of knowledge about those ethnic identities, which in the US is common for a lot of different groups. Does that help define that for all of you? Yeah? Okay. I'll keep coming around. See, any other big questions about it?
I know that some of you have heard of these things before, but throughout our lives, there's always going to be a new layer that we're going to discover, or a new layer that comes to the surface, okay? So it's okay to continually think about our social identities as we move throughout our lives. But for today, let's talk about today, two questions. First one is self-awareness. What did you become more aware of for yourself today? And then secondly, what did you learn about another person today that was interesting for you? Okay. Let's hear some answers. Feel free to share for yourself or for another person. Don't be shy. Yes, sir?
You laid this out, and you spoke about it when you were here, but but things I think about often are gender and race, and I think that's something I picked up last year, is just understanding white privilege and what that is, and how that plays a role in my life. But the things I don't think about was ethnicity and how, I take pride in my Scottish heritage, but I think about being white way more than I think about my Scottish-Irish background. Okay. Yeah. I think that's how I feel like society's oriented. One of you alluded to that.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing. Yeah. Anybody else?
Well, I'm already in her class, and I've already talked about this with other people and her as well. But then I think for me, it's very interesting how I think more about my race than my ethnicity, because when I think about my race, I start thinking about the different stereotypes that are on my race, as well as like race as a general concept and how like there are different stereotypes that we put on to these different races and these social constructs that we have of these races as well, so that's one that I think of.
Great. Thanks so much for sharing. Who else? Yeah.
I thought it was just cool that there's tons of different identities on this wheel, and it's like reconciliation is not only just for race and ethnicity.
Yes.
And like for all of these different
things.
And I feel like we seem to just agree with that.
Yeah, we focus on the race thing a lot. And rightfully so, it is a big, big thing in our lives, but also there's other aspects that we could talk about as well. Love that. Anybody else? One more person.
Yep. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
The three of us were talking about gender and what it means to be a woman, especially on the Christian campus, all three of us, and what it means to like differently all our different ethnicities, what it means.
It's great. It's great. Thank you for sharing.
For me, it was like I was just going up this wheel, but I was more focused on like these two ladies' personalities. Kind of getting a little dialogue that's kind of like, you know, it was cool. Like, you know, I was thinking about, you know, all this on the wheel, but just the personality aspect of how personalities really are and how those experiences shape that personality.
Yep. Yeah.
So I thought that was.
That's great. Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing. Okay.
Because I feel like there are things that other people see first in me, and so I'm self-conscious of that, and that's what I think about most often. Mm-hmm. But when I think about who I am, it's defined by other characteristics.
Yeah. Do you want to?
Yeah, so
yeah,
actually,
great. Thank you for sharing.
What we were going to talk about next and lead into mm-hmm. is I was actually going to tell you a little bit about myself and some of my identities that I've been briefly alluding to today. But there's a really important part of a social identity theory called salience. Okay, and salience is that depending on where you are, certain identities might be more prominent than others. Okay, and so even if you feel a certain way, other people might see those identities as more important in that context, or those are the ones that they mm-hmm. notice. So for example, I am a woman, okay? And when I go to our church, I am the wife of the youth pastor, okay? And I'm the mother of a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old who are very much 5 and 2, running around, screaming, having fun, and ridiculously cute, right? But a lot of people at church don't know that I'm a professor at Biola, okay? To them, I am a mom. And some of them don't even know that I work outside the home. And so to them, I'm a mom, okay? And that's a really interesting thing for me to experience, because then, you know, Monday through Friday, I'm on campus and I'm Professor Colley. Like, it doesn't matter so much that I have kids and that I have a husband. That's all nice and well and good. But what matters is my academic credentials and my ability to teach my classes well and research that I do. So all of a sudden, those identities become more prominent, even though I'm still a woman in both of those places. But the way I'm viewed as a woman changes based on that context that I'm in. And that's an important part of identity to think about too. Mm-hmm. So that can definitely alter the way that other people see us and that we even feel in those different contexts as well. Even though, you know, actually I thought about what you said, Mackenzie, about walking through a parking lot the other night, and I was thinking like, wow, I'm feeling so much like a woman right now walking through this parking lot. So mm-hmm. at night. So those things are mm-hmm. still key throughout.
Mm-hmm. So saliency, that's the key word there. Any more additions or questions about that before we start to move on to talk about how we engage with others? Great. So we said self-awareness is the key step. But throughout our lives, we're becoming more self-aware. It doesn't stop at the end of your undergraduate career. You know, Dorothy and I are almost 40 at this point. And we are so much more aware than we have ever been. But still, we have blind spots, right? So this is a journey. Also, another journey is becoming more aware of others and what their journey has been like. And so one of the key ways in order to engage with others is actually this concept called cultural humility. How many of you heard of this idea before? Cultural humility. Yeah, it's becoming more and more popular these days to talk about. It's a posture. Cultural humility is a posture of openness with others. Is it a posture of desiring to understand another person with his or her own unique history, unique social identity, and then their values? And the whole idea is not necessarily just to conquer them, to understand them, but to really know them well. It's the opposite of pride, right? It is engaging with others, desiring to learn about them, to learn with them, and to learn from them. Three prepositions in the English language, right? About, with, and from. But if you change the preposition, the posture is a little different. And so cultural humility engages in all three ways. I want to learn facts about you, but also I want to walk with you, and maybe I want to learn from you at some point. It is a posture of reconciliation. We talked a little bit in the beginning about Jesus' greatest command to us. You know, there is a vertical and a horizontal, and this is very much part of the horizontal reconciliation between people. If we engage with each other as human beings, not just stopping at what we see, but really seeking to understand their stories, it is a huge posture of reconciliation. And I would say, I said this yesterday in my last session, this is the greatest gospel witness to the lost world. That if we, as brothers and sisters, want to know each other, seek to understand each other, and work out what's going on with all the conflicts that we have within each other, this is better than preaching. This is actually showing people the Jesus that we serve, right? Right? posture of cultural humility also looks beyond the behaviors that we see and seeks to understand deeper the values they represent. This is not natural for us, though. This is learned. We ask the Holy Spirit to continually give us eyes to see and ears to hear, and what are our blind spots as we engage with others? This is mutually beneficial, not just seeking our own good, but also for the other. As we engage with this posture, the opposite of pride, the opposite of self-advancement, we will start to engage in a way that Jesus did, moving past assumptions, creating a safe space, engaging as a learner, and building bridges. But in order to do that, we have to actually confront our assumptions that we have about each other. We have so many assumptions. And so to talk about assumptions, Doro is going to come up and share a little bit of her story.
Now you all know my nickname, too.
Oh,
my
nickname Doro, is Doro. Yeah, Doro.
That's what all That's the people so that have known me for a long time call me.
Yeah.
So as we start thinking about how we can work through these things, we oftentimes start with assumptions, right? Mm-hmm. So let's say will you go to the next slide?
Oh, you want to put it up, all of those questions?
Yeah, just really
sure.
fast.
Okay.
So let's say you have Stephanie and I standing in front of you, right?
You
we are two white women in academia. So when you walked into this room, some of you knew us already, but a lot of you didn't. What were some of the assumptions that you made about us? You've learned some stuff. Some of you are like, I don't know.
I'd actually love to hear some of the assumptions that you heard about us. She wants to tell us something. No? Yeah.
You know us both pretty well.
You might assume that we've never traveled internationally. Hmm? What else? Tell us some of your assumptions.
Moms. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I'm single. I've never been married. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Great. It's a great, yeah, you assume. Mm-hmm. Good. What else?
Mm-hmm. Open when you talk to people. You face this way.
Good. I like that you bring Thank that you. Up because sometimes our assumptions, we're always thinking they're negative, but some assumptions could be true and positive, right? Mm-hmm. I assume she's an open person. Mm-hmm. Good. What else?
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Yeah.
And that's a lot because of the way we look too, right? Mm-hmm. So to tell you a little bit about my story, I actually grew up in the Philippines. My parents still are missionaries there. They've been missionaries there since 1986. And so you wouldn't assume by looking at me that I grew up with a monkey, okay? This is my dad with Moy Moy, okay? His name was Moy Moy, and Moy Moy is kind of like calling, his name is kind of like calling a cat kitty, okay? In the Philippines you call, because monkeys are all over the place, you call monkeys Moy Moy. Okay, so this was Moy Moy. This was the house that I grew up in, was right behind here, that actually was washed away in the storm that hit the Philippines 2 years ago. I forget, what is it called in the U.S.?
Tsunami?
No, it wasn't a tsunami, it was a storm surge, but it's called Haiyan in the Philippines. I forget what it was called here. But it was centered in the town that I grew up in. But you wouldn't guess by looking at us, right, that I grew up with a monkey and that Stephanie has a deathly fear of chickens.
I do. I hate those chickens.
She is very, very afraid of chickens. But those parts of our identity are actually really formational and strong in terms of how we see one another. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to give you a really brief story about how this came to be. And just briefly, too, it can show you, many of you might not expect that as you're talking about knowing another language, that I grew up going to Chinese school. So this is my first day of Chinese school when I was 8 years old. Can anybody see where I am?
Oh my God.
Yep, I'm right here. See the little redheaded girl? So for that whole year, I was the only white kid in a whole school of 800 people. And the second year, there were two of us. Okay, and so I know what it's like to be the only person like me in a particular environment. Mm-hmm. So to give you a story, though, of how what assumptions can do, is when I had my first child, Lillian, I was coming off the pain medication and I was in the hospital. Apparently they were supposed to give me some special electric blanket because I was coming off the morphine from having had a C-section and I was freezing cold. And so my husband got every single blanket and covering and piece of clothing we had in our backpacks and everything and put them all on top of me, right? So I'd just been in labor for 2 days. I had all of my hair piled up on top of my head like this. And so all you could see of me was like this poof of hair, okay, under the blankets. So the nurse comes in the middle of the night when I haven't eaten or slept in 2 days to do a hearing test on my baby. So my husband, who is also a white man, or not also, because he's white also and is a man, when the nurse came in to check my baby, she sees, you know, this poofy red hair, she sees this white guy, and she sees a white baby. And so these two nurses come in and I'm sitting there like literally shaking because I'm so cold. If you've ever been so sick, you had a fever and that was happening, you couldn't control how much you were shaking. So I was shaking like that. And I was sitting there under the covers and I hear the women like take my daughter and they're starting to do the hearing test and my daughter's screaming. And all of a sudden they switched from English to a dialect from the Philippines called Cebuano, which was spoken on the island next to the one that I grew up on. And so I don't speak Cebuano fluently, but I know some of it. So they were kind of speaking partially Cebuano, partially Tagalog, the national language of the Philippines. So I heard them talking and talking and, you know, trying to explain things. And I was like shaking, I was sick, I hadn't eaten, I hadn't slept. And all of a sudden I heard these nurses say, buong buong. Anybody have a guess what does buong buong mean? Anybody know? It means crazy. And I, all of a sudden, jumped up in my bed and said, who are you calling crazy? You call my baby crazy? Because she was screaming, right? And I thought my mama bear tendencies all came out in that 1 second because I thought these nurses were calling my baby crazy. But I didn't say, who are you calling crazy? I started yelling at them in three Filipino dialects, okay? Like my cobbled together Filipino dialects. Literally, guys, one of the nurses was so scared. She stopped what she was doing. She dropped the machine and she ran out of the room and refused to come back in the rest of the time that we were in the hospital because she was so shocked by me. And the other nurse, because she was holding my daughter, kind of like put her down and was like, okay, and like, you know, was speaking to me in English, trying to be like, who are you? Like, why, what is going on here? And trying to understand where I was and where I was coming from, because you couldn't just tell that by looking at me, okay? And all of us carry things like that with us, don't we? A lot of the identities that you looked at on that paper, a lot of those are hidden. How we feel about ourselves. And so we can't just make the assumption that I can call, and they weren't calling my baby crazy, they were calling the hearing testing machine crazy, okay? But I found that out, right? Another assumption. I thought that they were talking about my child. And so we have to be really careful and ask questions, right? It would have been better for me to say, excuse me, who are you calling buong buong, as opposed to starting to yell in three different languages at them. And so Stephanie is going to,
Should we skip that part and go to the questions?
Okay.
Let's go to talk about how to ask good questions to move past our assumptions.
All right.
You want to do that?
That's great.
Sorry, you don't hear my story today. You might have to ask me later.
I'm sorry.
I'll pass. Okay.
Pass. All right. So one of the things that we wanted to talk to you, though, about is asking good questions, right? Remember, that was our second objective for the day. And as we're learning how to get to know one another and ask questions, it's important to know how to do that well. And so I wanted to talk to you a little bit about something called strategic questioning. And strategic questioning is a wonderful tool for helping us go beyond just the really basic questions like, you know, hi, how are you? What's your name? What's your major? What school are you from, right? What residence hall do you live in? What part of student government are you in? And how to go to the next level in that regard, okay? So within strategic questioning, the first thing that we look at is that we want to ask open-ended questions of people. Okay, to learn how to ask open-ended questions. And this seems really simple, but if you haven't practiced it a lot before, it can be kind of challenging. Could anybody give me an example of an open-ended question? Anybody know what that is? What's an open-ended question you could ask somebody when you're getting to know them?
Laura.
What's a favorite memory from when you grew up?
Awesome. Okay, so what's a favorite memory from when you grew up? And that's open-ended because you can't answer that with a yes or a no, right? or a one-word answer, okay? You're gonna have to have at least a sentence or a paragraph to answer that. So strategic questions are open-ended, okay? The second thing is that they can't be answered with an either or, okay? So you're not gonna be getting into dichotomies because, and again, those are really close-ended, aren't they? When you're asking somebody something that could be one or the other. Like if you're going out to eat, right? If you ask somebody, you know, would you rather go have tacos or would you rather go have pizza? That's really an either or, right? Because maybe they don't want tacos or pizza, maybe they want Greek food, or maybe they want to have shabu shabu, right? Or maybe they want sushi. And so that's an either or, now I really want shabu shabu. That's an either or question. And you want to be able to push beyond that to say, what are you feeling like eating tonight, right? And that's more open-ended to allow them to actually express what they're thinking about, okay? So the next type of question that we wanna think about are questions that don't end in advice. Because a lot of times we do that. For those of you that grew up in the church, it's like when you're in prayer meetings, right? And you ask people for a prayer request, and in their prayers for you, they're like praying and trying to tell you what to do in the prayers. And have you ever experienced that before? Okay, that's a little bit painful if you've ever experienced that before. And so sometimes the questions we get are like that, right? So how many of you get asked by your parents, your grandparents, whoever your primary caregiver was, what are you gonna do with this degree you're paying a lot of money to get when you graduate? Right, any of you ever get that? But the question can sometimes end in advice, like, so when are you going to graduate school, right? Mm-hmm. That's not really asking you when you're going to graduate school, that's kind of trying to tell you like you should be going to graduate school, okay? And it's not allowing you to be able to talk about what you're thinking and feeling about your trajectory and where you see yourself going. And then the last part of question asking is to be able and willing to ask the unaskable question. There are a lot of unaskable questions. If you ask my students, if they have me in class for long enough, I ask some unaskable questions in class sometimes, don't I? Okay, because I want you to be able to push through and I actually wanna know what's going on there. So for example, with the question of what are you gonna do when you graduate, okay? That's not a really great question and I feel you that that's hard, but what about asking someone a question and said like, where do you see yourself in 5 years, okay? What area of the country do you see yourself living in? If you could live anywhere, actually in the world, where would you be living and who would be living with you, right? That gets at a lot more interesting things and actually accurate things about who that person is and where they want to go than just saying like, what are you going to do when you graduate? I don't know what I'm going to do when I graduate, right? Like hopefully have some sort of employment and maybe live with my parents, maybe not. Who knows beyond that, right? But do you see how those questions push beyond the very simple to dig into deeper things to be able to understand people from a more depth-filled perspective?
So let's practice this now. Yeah, I want you to meet someone new. How does that sound? A little risk-taking. We know that trust hasn't been built quite so much, so take it slow and practice asking strategic questions. First, you might want to ask them their name. Maybe, well, you know, couple information questions. But then take about 5 minutes to move past the basic and try some of these question styles. Does that sound okay, you guys? Okay, so 5 minutes, go. Thank you all so much for engaging so well with one another. I know that takes a lot of risk, especially maybe for an introvert like me. It's a little bit more to get out there. So I really appreciate that. How did that feel? Was it okay? Yeah?
I met Nathan, and also being kind of an introvert, it was kind of hard to ask those, like, think about those opening questions, but it was pretty cool.
Good. You challenge yourself a little bit, get out there. Good for you. Anybody else? Yep.
I think you actually had to have a mix of it, because sometimes you did have to ask just close-up questions, like, what is your major?
Yeah.
But then transitioning into a more broader, like, how can I fill this?
Excellent. So not stopping there with a closed end. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're an entry point to which you can then expand, right? Maybe the closed end questions sometimes create some trust a little bit too. Yeah, good. What else? Yeah.
I feel like I'm usually so annoyed with surface level conversation. Mm-hmm. It was cool to see, like, once you ask open-ended questions, how it can go a lot deeper.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You guys probably could have talked for hours, right? Like new friend here in the room. Isn't that awesome?
Can I just say one thing about that?
Yeah, totally.
I think that sometimes it feels like a great relief doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Because you don't have to be pretending to be like what's the next snippet of this little thing, but then you can actually get to know somebody too, and it allows them to expose some of their self and be listened to, which we'll be talking about next. But I think it's a relief sometimes to feel that.
Great job, you guys. So far today, we've talked about two things. Number one, our social identity is becoming more self-aware. First step. Number two, learning to ask harder questions. And number three, which I think this one is actually the most difficult one, learning to listen well. Stephen Covey says, most people do not listen with the intent to understand. They listen with the intent to reply. Mm. And we see this everywhere in our world today, right? Politics, Donald Trump. We see talk shows. Did I say that? It's on camera. Uh-oh. We see talk shows. Talk shows, people are talking over each other, right? They're not listening to each other to understand what's going on. They just want their thoughts and ideas out there for the world to hear them. And if we actually think about this, this is true for ourselves as well. There's a lot of pride associated with that. But this is what Dwight Elmer says. He's a missiologist. Listening may be one of the most effective expressions of love for a person. And what do we talk about with the greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. Listening may be one of the most important expressions of love. But let me ask you this, are you a good listener? It takes time. It takes a lot of skill to cultivate. Think of someone you know listens well. What are some of their characteristics? What do you think? Someone you know that listens well, yeah.
Eye contact,
excellent. What else? Yeah.
Their posture is facing towards
you. Mm-hmm. An openness with their posture, right? I think you said that earlier too, right? Good.
Their nonverbals, looking more engaged with you.
Looking more engaged with you, nonverbals, excellent, yeah?
Ask a lot of questions.
Then maybe ask some, yeah, they really are curious to know. Excellent. They might ask you some follow-up questions. Yeah, good.
The questions may be connected, like it goes more in depth. Mm-hmm. From surface to
So what you guys are saying is that listening is connected to strategic questions. Oh, they're engaged. What? Anything else? Yeah.
Affirmative responses.
They don't try to correct you. They really try to understand where you're coming from.
Excellent, excellent. All these things are wonderful. I just want to add one layer on top of that. If you mentioned eye contact and nonverbal communication, all of these things within communication are culturally bound. So we need to also be aware of the home culture that someone comes from. So for example, I work with a lot of international students. And the very first time I worked with some Korean students, as their professor, they wouldn't look at me, they looked at the ground. And I thought this was so disrespectful. Why wouldn't they look me in the eye? But actually, the opposite was true. They were showing respect to me in their culture as an older person. So keeping in mind that sometimes what we assume is happening in this communication might not be correct, and that we need to check our assumptions. Does that make sense, you guys? So yeah, for us, eye contact, for me, it's really important. But for another person, it might not be. So we need to check those things. Think about your listening skills. Would you consider yourself a good listener? Why or why not? Don't answer. That's just for you. That's just for you to think about. Maybe when we're talking about listening well, I have a few things here that I think that are the most salient. Listening begins with self-awareness. So that's why we started there today. You can't listen until you're aware of yourself. A good listener stays present. And this is hard, you guys. My phone is constantly ringing and people are texting me and I wanna be connected. Anybody? People are walking by while I'm talking to somebody and I wanna talk to them too. I get distracted so easily. But a good listener stays present. And sometimes that means making the choice to be in a conversation away from other people or to turn your phone off. Listening is remembering. Remembering what somebody says now and then later following up with them. Listening means taking the perspective of the other, being more aware of what's going on in their lives, kind of like I said about the Korean students that I was working with. And then finally, This is probably the hardest part. A good listener reflects back what they're hearing. So what I hear you saying is, blah, blah, blah. Is that correct? Because guess what? You're checking your assumptions. Now, that might even help the other person to clarify what they meant. Maybe they didn't even know what they meant. Sometimes some of us are external processors. Anybody external? You just start talking, ideas start coming. Anybody? Yeah? This is really good for external processors because we're like, oh, did I say that? I didn't mean that. Let me say this. Internal processors have a little bit of a different time, right? We think a lot and then we might get it out. Now, let's practice this together with each other. This is our last activity for the day. You guys doing okay? Yeah. Isn't this great? So fun. Let's do a listening activity. Final thing.
All right, so this is what we are going to do in order to practice listening and the different aspects that Stephanie was just bringing up. What you're going to do, and before you move into doing this, let me give you all of the directions. You are going to grab a partner, okay? And what I want you to do is I want you to be able to sit so that you are knee to knee with them. So luckily, most of the chairs in this room will move around in some way to enable you to do that. Okay, so you're going to sit knee to knee with them, and you're going to pick somebody to be the speaker first and the listener first. What's going to happen is the speaker is going to recount to the listener a favorite childhood memory, okay? And during this time, I want the listener to just practice listening. Okay? You're not gonna ask questions. You're just gonna listen. And then you're gonna have 30 seconds to recount back to the speaker what they just told you. And so you have to remember it, and then you'll switch. Okay?
Does that make sense?
Can you do it? So what did you learn? Just one or two things quickly due to time. What did you learn by doing this exercise about your speaking and listening abilities?
You have to keep paying attention even while you're retaining with it.
Yes. That's hard to do, isn't it? So you're listening and trying to remember at the same time. Mm-hmm.
I think it's really hard because everyone was speaking at a normal tone, so you had to ignore everyone else.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Especially like choosing places where you're going to talk with people. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and sometimes it's not just what's going on the outside, it's what's going on the inside too, right? If the other person's talking about something that makes you uncomfortable or you have to go to the bathroom, right? That distracts you
right?
from your ability to listen. Ashley, and then Jonathan, and then...
Like, you have to learn to, like, drown out the sound around you because it's like you have to focus on, like, one voice out of, like, numerous voices in the room.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, to focus on what they're saying. Oh, yeah.
We were both trying to, like, when I started laughing, my tone changed. When he laughed, his tone changed. It's kind of like noticing that difference in tone. And when you're kind of, like, retelling an exciting memory, your facial expression is more, like, relaxed. It's more, you know, you're into it, where it's, like, a kind of an awkward movie, kind of, like, like a trip or something. Okay. Like, reserved, which actually did happen.
Yeah, and then I don't know if it was, like, just because he was the first person to give his memory, it was hard for me to pay attention, but still, because I was still trying to think about a memory to say thanks. So I was trying to actively listen, but then also trying to think about myself.
Yeah, so wasn't that the obstacle that she talked about in that, though, too?
Yeah.
Like, what do we try to insert into the conversation, into our listening, what we want to say next? And so that's definitely an obstacle. So let's have the last comment, because we need to move on to...
And that's exactly what I was doing. I realized that while she was talking, I was like, okay, how am I going to say this exactly how she said it? I'm like, wait a second, no, I'm supposed to be listening right now. And there's so many different parts of it that, like, key details that I missed out just because I was trying to form how I was going to say it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good. Can we one more right here?
Oh, I just found that I like to ask questions when I listen to people. And that is really difficult to not, but when I don't ask questions, he tells me what he wants to say instead of what I want to hear.
Yes. Ooh, I just got chills, you guys. That was good.
That's one of the key parts of strategic questioning, actually, is you want what is important to the other person to come out, not your agenda for the conversation. Because then you're able to get through assumptions, and they'll actually tell you normally a lot of those things that otherwise they wouldn't. So I'm so glad that you brought that up. Thank you. And I'm sorry, because I know a couple more of you have comments on that particularly, but just for the sake of time, we need to move to ask you. So just from generally really being here with us today as we talk about cultural humility, learning to ask good questions and strategic questions, and listening. What are just a couple of things that you'll be taking away from this session today?
Savannah?
Listening is more important than we actually perceive it to be.
Good. Very Thanks for sharing.
Listening is a lot more difficult than we
think. Yeah. Yes. It's hard. Yeah, it is hard.
Listening takes work, and you have to, for me, when I listen to people, I want to solve their problem. Sometimes just listening is solving the problem.
Yep.
That's good stuff.
Very much so.
We might need to start with self-awareness and introspection on how people are engaging in these conversations.
Mm, absolutely.
Did you have your hand raised? Oh,
okay. Right here.
There's value in what other people have to offer. Mm-hmm. For us, so.
Absolutely.
Very much so.
You're affirming their dignity by doing that, yeah.
Oh, just because it's not your name doesn't mean that it isn't your.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Excellent. Over here.
I really liked what you said about cultural humility and how it's the greatest gospel message to the lost world. Mm. I just feel like so many times we can be so distant from each other. Mm. And I just feel like that's the exact opposite of what we should be doing, especially when it comes to proclaiming the gospel.
Yeah, absolutely.
Doing what Christ has us have to do.
Yeah,
very much so.
Thank you for sharing. Yeah. Anybody else?
I think just feeling the weight of the importance of being self-aware, because you have to start with yourself and realizing what assumptions you're bringing, where you're coming from, because communication is a two-way street, and even if you're saying something, you might be sending a message that you don't want to send, and so realizing how many mistakes I make in communication, how much grace I'm hoping to receive from other people.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely. And then,
I think being mindful and being more active in the conversation, because listening and responding is not a very passive thing to do.
No, it's not at all. And we think that it is sometimes, but that's just hearing. Yeah. Listening is being very responsive.
Takes a lot of energy, right? Takes a lot of energy.
And then you said there was one more?
She said no. Anybody else? You guys have been amazing today. We hope that you really enjoyed this.
Hold on, before you pack up,
we would like to pray a prayer over you. And then after that, you're gonna take a little survey to give us some feedback on our time together today. How does that sound?
Okay, so if you can all please stand up.
Stand, we're gonna say a prayer over you. You wanna do?
All right, let's pray.
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace.
Where there is hatred, let me sow love.
Where there is injury, pardon.
Where there is doubt, faith.
Where there is despair, hope.
Where there is darkness, light.
And where there is sadness, joy.
O divine master,
grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console.
To be understood as to understand.
To be loved as to love.
For it is in giving that we receive.
It is in pardoning that we are pardoning.
And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life.
Amen.
Thank you all very much.
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.